Please rise for the pledge allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence for the sick, handicapped, departed, and the military personnel of this community. Thank you. Roll call for this.
Mike Fulmer.
Here.
Bruce Valandici.
Here.
Bill Henderson.
Here.
Joe Lyons.
Here.
Joe Lazzano.
Here.
Joe Ducey.
Here.
Cherry.
Here.
Pat Blaisdell.
Here.
Tom McDermott.
Here.
Andrew Sykes.
Here.
Greg and Julie Cohen.
Here.
Councilman Lanis.
Here.
Bill Trudeau.
Here. All right, is there a visitor? Council calls Mary Weiss, please.
Just to say, you know, this sign up here. Very short and sweet. Tomorrow night at 7 o'clock over at the railroad station, the caboose, whatever you want to call it, there will be another talk about Bridgeville. And the topic is Bridgeville 1901, which is the year we became Bridgeville. Very much a borough separate from Upper St. Clair. That's at 7 o'clock tomorrow night. And I also have brought with me program notices, which I'll give you when you leave tonight. I would like you to get active. I'd like to see you all program at the end of the month, which is the memorial to Roberto Clemente and his Clemente Museum. We have great programs at the Fire Hall once a month, and then we have smaller ones over there, and we're getting between 25 and 30 people over here every month. Please join us. Thank you.
Oh, Mayor. Council calls Bob Fryer, please.
Yes, thank you. I was thrilled to read the newspaper last week. I guess it was Lori's statement that I'm meeting with Dan Cessna that the bridge is going to be 7 lanes wide down here. And they also mentioned, Lori mentioned that they're going to add the other 150-yard long extra lane. But I noticed $500,000. Are any of the other communities that run more cars over that stretch of Churchill Street than us? BridgevillePA or anything?
It's basically us and BridgevillePA.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Upper St. Clair or not?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. The other thing I wanted to ask Joe, last time I was here, I know I missed a couple of meetings, but Joe was concerned about the water flow under the South End Bridge, and he mentioned they might have to raise that. I'm assuming that that's not necessary.
I honestly, Bob, when Lori and I were at another meeting on Thursday of last week, and the project was brought up, as PennDOT did this overall Southern District 11 project update, and Cheryl Moon Serrani mentioned that, and they're still trying to get some kind of clearance or direction from the Army Corps of Engineers, so they haven't resolved that matter yet. So I don't know.
You're still waiting.
They're still waiting to get an answer from the Corps.
Yeah. I was going to say, when you mentioned that to me, I went down and measured the vertical height of those concrete beams. I think they're about 48 inches. I'm no engineer, but I'm assuming that if push comes to shove, by simply using steel beams in there, they can use a much lower, beam height.
I think it's a good observation, Bob, because, you're right, they're using concrete there. They probably could use a shallower, wider beam.
Yes, right.
If they have to, but again, they're trying to get direction from the Army Corps of Engineers, and then I think the other factor that comes into big play here is whether anybody realizes or not, you've got to get approval from the Federal Highway Administration for some of the money, because even though there might be money being contributed from Bridgeville and South Fayette, and there's money coming from the PennDOT funding sources,
private sources too.
Private sources, There's probably some element there that has to have Federal Highway Administration approval too. So you've got a lot of, people stirring the pot.
Yeah, well, it's a, we're so far in getting a bridge, we're sort of the lucky ones.
Yes.
Because they build a bridge every 75
Right.
or 100 years, so at least that provides an option for us to do something about the traffic congestion.
I mean, from the Flood Control Authority, I mean, I'll give my direction to the authority not to resist having to do anything to that bridge. I mean, make sure that we give them the necessary right of way that they need to expand the bridge if necessary. That's the reason why we should.
I noticed something else, well, I don't think.
Well, can I, what's the point of that statement?
What statement?
About the bridge.
The last time I was here, Joe said that they might have to raise the bridge. That would be sort of a catastrophe, considering if you raise a bridge 2 feet and you have two four-lane roads on each side, that's not really an enticing feature, you understand?
Yep.
Well, you know, here's the other option, you even said it yourself, Bob, there, you know, the depth of the beams. It may come down to maintain the elevation and grade of that deck of that bridge. Maybe they gotta replace all the substructure.
I don't know if you will.
They might, you know, who's not?
That's all I'm working on.
Yeah, no doubt about it, the PennDOT guys are ingenious. The other thing I wanted to ask you, related to the bridge. I had sent a message, or I asked PennDOT to please put that left turn stacking lane in. A week or so later, I think Gloria mentioned they were gonna put the left turn stacking lane in for cars that went up Chartier Street. Have you guys heard, or have you and Joe heard anything definite about that?
No, I think it'll be probably late fall, early winter before we see even a conceptual design.
The first drawing, true.
Because, I mean, we got a request there last week for some utility information from McCormick Taylor, who's doing the design work. So they're still doing the design.
And they were out there today.
Yeah.
No, that's one. Again, I wanna mention again, these are just little bits and pieces that you guys tell me, I'm sort of following up on. It's important that when they widen, put that extra lane on Chartier Street, that they increase the radius, so there's a nice welcoming turn for motorists that come into Bridgeville. And talking about radius turns, the Washington Avenue Hickman Street turn by the post office, I wish you'd think about that and see the importance of that. If that turn can be, if it can be made more gradual, right, it makes it easier for people to make that turn. Not only that, with that being a convenient right turn, the people, because Chess Street runs parallel with Washington Avenue all the way through town, if you make that right turn easier so that people aren't afraid of getting hit by the traffic heading south on Washington Avenue, I think the people will find that second optional route, and I think it would reduce the traffic burden on Main Street.
I do think the change in the painting that happened, was that last year or this year?
Yeah.
You know, I think that's somewhat helped improve that, because now you're not pulling out into the traffic, you're pulling onto a lane where people aren't. And I know some people still go over, but at least it's been improved.
Yeah, but the nice thing about that, you can reduce that, you can increase that radius to about 63 feet. That's the inside radius. You have a great opportunity there. Also, if there's ever, if a time ever comes where we're lucky enough to get a traffic light at that intersection, with that increased radius, cars can go from Hickman Street right across to James Street very easily. That's your biggest parking lot. I know that you think that's a minor thing, but it's quite important. So what would you consider that?
Thanks, Bob.
And I can't think of anything else I need to ask you about. And congratulations on getting the 7-lane bridge.
Thanks, Bob. All right. Nino.
Yes.
You're talking on planning commission?
Yes.
You want to wait till after, or do you have anything?
Sure, after.
All right. Because we have you slated for planning.
Go ahead.
Thanks.
Just pass this to the guys.
Minutes. A motion of the Borough Council regarding the minutes of the March 13, 2017 regular meeting has submitted.
So moved.
Second.
Who is that? Bill? All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. 2017 pavement maintenance program. Bids were advertised publicly open on Friday, April 7th, 2017, at 10 a.m. in the council chambers for the 2017 pavement maintenance program with the following bid results. All right, here we go. Youngblood Paving, 10% bid block, bid of $151,737.80. Grande Industries, 10% bid bond for a bid of $159,708. Victor Paving, 10% bid bond, $170,106.25. Paciano Contracting, 10% bid bond, $178,243.50. T.A. Robinson, 10% bid bond, $181,144.75. Maria Amelia and Sons, 10% bid bond, $181,412.90. Morgan Excavating, 10% bid bond, $186,156.50. Shields Asphalt, 10% bid bond, $94,923.75. And Alex Barris at 10% bid bond, $202,094.50.
Which one?
The motion is the Borough Council regarding the award of the bid to the lowest responsible bidder, Youngblood Paving, in the amount of $151,737.50, contingent upon review of all required documentation by engineer sites. Remarks. $74,966.25 will be reimbursed through a project share agreement with the Pennsylvania American Water Company.
I'll make the motion.
All right. Bruce?
Second.
And Bert? All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Motion carries. Yes, while we're on that, we looked at Hickman Street and the water companies work there and the short part of New York Street.
So I think New York Street passed. I got a call from Golden Triangle Contracting about 2 weeks ago, indicating to me that they were going to start doing the trenching pegging on New York Street. Mm-hmm. They were anticipating the opening of the asphalt plants, and then like end of that week, I got a call and said, we're not coming until further notice. So they know that, and I asked them to pay the full width of the road.
Okay, that's how, and same thing for Hickman Street?
Yeah, I think it is policy. Yeah.
And we've got, I mean, there's Hickman, there's Ramsey, there's Chess.
Yeah.
They're coming through again, so probably what's going to happen again next year is the same thing that's happening this year.
Yeah.
That we'll do a share for. We can't keep up with all these roads as they're doing, so they're probably.
Right, they're moving at a very nice speed.
Right.
I bring up Hickman specifically because they're going. They've finished all their covenants. So they're going to be ready to pay this season. And I know that's not on your list. And that's what's concerning me.
We don't have a budget.
We don't have the money for it. They're going to, let me get a contract.
Again, that may be something that we look at. That's why I'm bringing it up because there's a certain efficiency of doing the floor width right. When it should be done.
On the call.
Okay. Ordinance number 995, motion of the Borough Council regarding ordinance number 995, ordinance amending Chapter 16, Parks and Recreation, Part 2, Parks, Rules and Regulations, 203, prohibited conduct to prohibit smoking of tobacco and the use of electronic nicotine devices, e-cigarettes, and borough public parks. The ordinance has been duly advertised.
Tom, we have some language.
So, one would have to offer that.
Yeah.
It's been advertising as it is, so if somebody would make a motion to tweak it, it's.
And not have to advertise.
Beg your
pardon? And not have to advertise.
That would be a matter of council. If somebody makes a motion to add language, that would be seconded, debated, added. If it wasn't, then you would make a motion. If it did pass, then on the amended text. But right now, the text has been amended just as. I mean, the text has been advertised as it.
If we table it, we don't have to advertise.
You don't have to re-advertise it.
Okay.
No matter what you get. You can pass it as is. One can make a motion to amend the language, which, in my opinion, given the nature of it, does not require re-advertising.
Okay. It might be of us to
chief's not here tonight, sit down with the chief and say, you know, you're the one that's going to have to enforce it.
We make a motion to table.
Everyone, I just highlighted some suggested language. I'll send it to Lori. She can throw it in your package or I'll email it out. I haven't highlighted it, it would be an easy fix, and again, that's constant.
I'll say.
All those in favor of tabling?
Aye.
Motion carries. Thank you. Proposed ordinance number 996. Motion to Borough Council authorizing manager Collins to advertise proposed ordinance number 996. An ordinance authorizing the execution of an intergovernmental cooperation agreement with other local municipalities establishing the Robinson Run / Chartiers Creek Municipal Watershed Alliance and providing for the governance thereof. Mount Pleasant Township, McDonald Borough, North Fayette Township, Oakdale Borough, Bridgeville Borough, Robinson Township, South Fayette Township, and we just found out that Collier Township are the additional municipalities that will make up this alliance.
And this ordinance, just by way of explanation, this authorizes you to sign the agreement that creates the initial thing. And under that agreement, it's quite flexible in two regards. One, it allows it to expand the long chart tiers and hopefully really the beachhead on that here. Part of it's centered on the tributary of Robinson. And within the agreement itself, because it was wanted by all the municipalities, kind of wanted it to be consensus-based and voluntary-based, and its main intent was to get a critical mass of folks together that can be able to get grant money and utilize that to do that, to get MS4 cross credits back and forth. But it also does those so that nobody feels bound money-wise or obligation-wise. All decisions that have any consequence of monetary value or commitment are by unanimity and consensus. However, within that, if a subgroup wants to go off and do something with their subgroup, they can do that as well. So,
is there a motion?
I have some questions.
I'll make a motion. Yeah, that way you can put it on the table.
Intergovernmental cooperation is a beautiful thing. Bureaucracy, however, is not a beautiful thing. We are part of the Chartiers Valley Flood Control Authority. We have our own parking authority. You can create layers of bureaucracy that don't make things happen better or faster, but instead slow things down and make things more difficult. MS4, which is, Joe, correct me, Municipal Separate Storm System?
Yes.
Storm what? Storm System?
Municipal Separate Storm Sewer System.
So it's a separate storm sewer system. Basically, this is rainwater that goes into the storm sewer system and that is now looking to get permits from the Department of Environmental Protection and the EPA. So that's what we're talking about, right? With these cross filings.
No, I'm sorry. Maybe I used a bad example.
No, that's
overall, that's a tangential slim benefit and even purpose. I'm sorry.
Okay.
That's just one that was mentioned. The main thing, and again, this was the impetus, frankly, of all the managers and engineers of these communities. And this is not building a bureaucracy. This is actually giving the legal authority for these guys, as they always do, to work informally together as a group, as they do well. This allows these communities to get together on projects that would benefit each other, along with that for flood control reasons beyond MS4. Frankly, primarily flood control oriented, not MS4. There's some ticket punching there on the side. Okay, but the primary thing here is for flood control. And frankly, it was. For primarily to get a critical mass and to help get like Corps grants, Corps of Engineers grants, and greater authorizations that they're reticent to give an individual community to step into these streams, that they're more likely to give, as you know, we've been talking about before. And the way this has been set up, though, it's kind of, I know you have to have legal words and document to some extent, but it has, by intent and purpose, been set up to be completely kind of non-bureaucratic, non-monetary, non-committal, completely voluntary, and envisioned to be primarily the managers and the engineers are coming back to council getting authorizations to try to do group projects within many municipalities where these engineers and managers know best what's on the ground in their own streams and communities. Did I say that fairly?
I think you did, Tom. Let me add that I think one of the other intents here is that, you know, some of these communities don't have a large public works department. They might have two or three men. Not everybody has a piece of equipment that can be used to clean up or do one of these projects. So the idea is that the municipalities work together with their equipment and forces to perform some of these projects together.
Shared services.
And it's interesting that you mention that, because, and I didn't want to throw both things down. I'm related to this, but actually dovetails on this. You'll notice that North Fayette Township and Mount Pleasant are involved in this agreement as well, and I have to represent both of those communities. Unrelated to this, I just did an intermunicipal agreement that was designed to allow their DPW departments on a managerial and DPW level to do equitable exchanges of services with each other. For example, they have to take an athi out somewhere, do road scraping. One has the equipment, the other doesn't. They're going to basically be able to do in-kind trade and keep a little tab back and forth. I envision that that agreement, which I will show you a sample of and circulate, I want to get this out of the way. This is a template. This is really, the focus is that specific thing. This other thing's more generic, and then these relationships can build as well, because beyond, you know, you have this thing going on here. If you have the intergovernmental agreement and you start working there together, you realize, oh, they've got that equipment, they've got that back and forth. You can do a lot of stuff that's kind of becomes many administrative, like cog level work that you guys are doing.
The flood authority is just a James and Fulton project, so that limits us.
Right.
Whereas this, we're talking about our tributaries and what we can do in those, and trying to get together, and like South Bend is there, Collier's there. So I know some of these communities are far away, some of them are not.
Right, and Collier adding to it means we're in the same watershed where our problem is.
Right, and
up until Collier came on board, it was this distant Robinson-Rum-Rod watershed that really, we're in a different watershed.
Well, Robinson is a part of the church.
I know that, but it's not part of the McLaughlin-Run watershed. It's different than the Robinson-Run watershed. But Collier's joining this really makes it a beautiful thing.
Well, we reached out to Collier for that purpose, but as you know,
because we're all in agreement.
Yeah. We should have. We have a lot of issues on this. It was, concern. Stormwater fee, bureaucracy.
There's no stormwater fee.
No,
Hold
on a second, Mr. President. Putting on the table concerns does not mean opposition. It means things that we've got to look at so that we don't enter into something that is not going to service our community well.
And we can always exit this agreement if we are not happy with how it's working. So
we'll take the show on the road to help go.
They're all coming here. They're all coming here on what the 7th, I can't remember what the date is.
Everyone's meeting here. I invited everyone to come here to meet here.
Yeah.
Trying to bring everyone.
May 7th?
I can't remember. I mean, that's open, right?
Yeah. I think it might be May 12th. I'll let you know.
Yeah,
they're all coming.
All right. There's a motion on the floor. There's a second session. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Bill list. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the April 2017 bill list.
I'll move.
Joe Carducci?
I'll second.
And Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Payrolls. Motion of the Borough Council approving the payrolls of April 14, 21, 28, and May 5th. 2017.
Second.
And Cherry, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Monthly reports. Motion to accept and pay any commissions due 2017 real estate tax collector reports. And Bruce Gallarucci, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Or any all those against? Motion carries. Motion to accept February 2017 financial report. Bruce Gallarucci, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the March 2017 police report.
So moved.
Bill Henderson?
Second.
And and Joe Lusno, all those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Motion to accept the March 2017 zoning report.
So moved.
Joe Henderson?
Second.
And Bruce Garucci, all those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Before we get to the committee reports, gentlemen with the steel hat, did you have anything? I didn't see you signed in, and I kind of went right through and apologized.
I was just attending the Boy Scout meeting.
All right, no problem. Welcome to the meeting. Thank you for coming.
Do you have any questions of us?
Not yet.
Okay. That's the answer. I was looking for it.
All right, administration, Bruce?
I don't have any.
Finance, Joe?
Nothing.
Parks and Rec?
Joe.
Other Joe?
I'm going to be a spoiled sporter. That's a short thing. The park's looking really nice. ECNR people came through, and they inspected Cook School and McLaughlin. That organization gives us money to work on the parks. Every couple of years, they come and check up and make sure we're keeping them up and everything. They had a small punch list for us, which our public works people are taking care of. Chartiers is looking pretty good. I guess hopefully we're going to be going for that grant next year or so, because we need some work down there. I noticed the behind Shelter 2, there's a playground back there. The one slide board had a little pretty good-sized hole. I don't know if it was vandalism or wear and tear. And the other side had a crack in it, which could be wear and tear. Those things are getting to be 15, 20 years old down there, so maybe we can do something with that next grant if we get one. That's all I have.
Thank you, Joe. Public Works?
The only thing I have, I noticed in your report, or that we're looking at the summer help, you...
Yes, I met with, it's through my work initiative.
Yeah.
And they're going to provide us with two individuals. They go to Charter Valley High School. They have experience in grass cutting, weed whacking, those type things. But before they come on board, I'm going up to meet them and do a little interview to make sure that I think that they're a good fit. And then I have a couple of our public works guys that I think would work well with them, and it's at no cost to us. The liability insurance is covered by the state, so it's some extra hands, and then it's letting some young people get a feel for what it feels like to work in this type of environment and, getting some experience, so. So it'll be June through August.
Okay, great, thanks. Public safety, Bill?
I have no reports.
Mr. Mayor?
Well, I have the distinct honor, a week or so ago, of making a proclamation regarding a new Eagle Scout, Jack Alberducci. And I see another potential Eagle Scout here in our audience. I'd like to make a point to them all. The sun does rise, and it will set without any of us. But what goes on during the day, what happens, is a matter of what we do, how we care about our community. So it's very nice to see you here, because it indicates that you care about your community. And that is vitally important, because we are just one generation away from losing it. Each generation has to earn what this country has to offer. And so I'm very happy to see you here. Regarding the public works, in addition to the curb painting and the other items, I'd like to add litter collection, especially on some of our neighborhood areas. Union Street comes to mind. There are a number of both public and abandoned areas where it'd be wonderful to have someone take on the risk on picking up litter that's there. Most people don't throw litter around. The majority, in fact, studies have shown that a very large majority of litter is caused by just randomness.
Well, the other day we had so much high wind, there was litter all
over town. Exactly, there's litter all over town. Yeah. What happens is that no one it's not necessarily your responsibility to pick it up. And, you know, obviously, I've been told, you know, pick, if you see it laying there, pick it up and throw it away. But some neighborhoods need a little bit more help. So if we could put that in. It's also on Union Street. We were successful in getting the fence removed from, the temporary fence removed from the property on James Street. There is a similar fence that has been on Union Street for many years since the steel mill removed their water tanks. I don't believe they even know that it sits there as an eyesore on Union Street.
Well, they cut it once or twice a year, so they know it's there.
Yes, but it is also its own bureaucracy. Mm-hmm. And perhaps we might just ask them if they might remove that fence, because it's obviously not securing anything any longer. I'm curious as to council's thoughts on this. If you have a piece of land, Union Street has a number of them, you know, up on both hills, there are areas where there's vacant lot. I think that we are just as well served by having that become a wooded area as by keeping it mowed and clean. Where I find objection is when it's sort of in between. In other words, not being kept, but looks like it's just not cutting your grass. And I'm curious as to the rest of council's thoughts on that, of letting a vacant parcel be reclaimed, becoming a wooded parcel, trees, nature, etc.
That's obviously what, you know, you see here that in urban areas all the time, turn into a community garden.
Yeah.
Is it a vacant lot or does somebody own it? That's the big difference.
Well, most of these places are owned.
Right, and that's the thing.
And, you know, what I'm saying is...
Obviously, if we own the property, we're going to...
No, we maintain... I'm talking about things that... about property...
Right.
Where we don't have that issue. I'm saying, I think it's reasonable to allow a lot if it doesn't have anything on it, like this Universal Cyclops lot, Universal Stainless. They come every 6 to 8 months.
They cut it in.
I'm going to suggest that instead of asking them, we ask them to let it grow naturally in a wooded area.
The only reason that we actually were asking them to cut it was because the neighbors adjacent to the lots were complaining that it wasn't cut.
Because it looks like it's supposed to be cut.
Yeah, so that's really the reason that we were asking them to cut it.
Right, and I'm saying if we allow it to go past just being a lot that's not cut and become a wooded area, now it's really rather attractive.
There's a lot, there's a universal lot mm-hmm. on the right-hand side of the road that is owned by, of course, Universal. Mm-hmm. And then there's a lot that used to have a house that's torn down. Mm-hmm. That's been purchased by someone. So mm-hmm. a private owner owns it. And then you have the Universal across the street.
Right.
So but there is a private owner does own that portion mm-hmm. of land that the house used to be. He's planning on building something.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'm not talking necessarily about something that somebody's trying to build on, etc. I'm saying, if we've got a lot that would be better served by not being cut, let's allow that to occur. Let's allow it to become a wooded lot and service us that way.
You just gotta be careful with critters and stuff too.
Well,
you know, you have a place for somebody yeah. next door, probably being partially maintained now. There's trees and stuff, and they have animals coming in their backyard that they didn't have before. So you gotta be careful.
We do get complaints for houses that have been demoed, and then we try to keep them cut down. But I just got a call this week about a house that you're working on now, 1245 Dustler, mm-hmm. that some neighbors have been noticing mice didn't have mice before, and that type of thing. So it's kind of
it's hard work.
It's kind of a catch 22.
Mm-hmm. One other question. I don't know if you'll know this. But someone asked me, how did you get into the works program that the Department of Labor is running? They didn't mention it at the COG meeting. I don't know the answer.
I called.
No, no, I mean, if you're a student or if you're looking for summer job.
They offer it at the school.
So it's through Churchill Valley High School?
Yes.
And so you go to your guidance?
You go to the guidance.
Guidance counselor there at Churchill Valley High School?
Yes.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, Pat. Chief's not here. Solicitor?
I have no opinion.
Report? I hear citing.
Thank you, Mr. President. First thing I have is the 2017 CCTV employment repair contract. We had the pre-construction meeting with AAA pipe cleaning on 31st of March, and then we'll be arriving next Monday to start the CCTV and cleaning. We've given them some direction on some critical areas in the system of the borough we want them to look at first, so that if there are repairs that needs to be done, they can be included as part of our point repair contract with Solite Construction. So hopefully we'll have some answers here within the next 2 weeks on a couple of these things. The next thing was the Alcosan Grove Green Grant. Lori and I went down to the Alcosan, I think it was the end of February, for an informational meeting to gather information regarding Alcosan's Grove Green Grant program. And what they are looking for, potential projects that will remove stormwater from the sanitary sewer system. So that's not water that's treated by Alcosan in their, with their treatment plant. And you know, they just, right before we went to that meeting, they had released some awards and also let some other communities know what projects did get funded. So we looked at a couple locations. We thought we could pull a grant application together for this grant round and decided that, you know, it's better for us to have a more complete application with better supporting documentation. There's two locations in the borough we'd like to look at that are existing drainage swales. They're below New York Street and above McLaughlin Road behind ABD Sprinkler. And these particular valves is a better term for them. There's both the sanitary sewer and it's the drainage swale where all the water comes to for that watershed. So we're looking at that. We're going to put some flow monitors into some of the manholes at the lower end of these to see what happens to the flow when we have a large storm event. We have a feeling about one, but one of them is probably more prevalent than the other one. So once we get that information and we can evaluate, if we can make a solid submission to Alcosan to get the funding needed to make the improvements. You know, one possibility would be to replace the entire sanitary sewer system up the one valley and maybe even pipe the storm sewer system. You know, we kicked around one idea in the office about since you got laterals coming from both sides down these valleys, lay the sanitary sewer first and then encase it in concrete and then put a storm sewer over top of it or form a concrete channel over top of it so the water's not getting into the sanitary sewer. We've got two things going with that. We're collecting sanitary sewage and we're collecting storm water at the same time. So we'll get that pulled together here and we have a solid grant application.
I got one on Coolidge. That one on Coolidge is a disaster.
Yeah. So. Okay, we addressed the 2017 road program, 2015 pavement maintenance by our road. I talked with A.T. Robinson a little bit last week. We're going to get together in the next week and schedule another pre-construction meeting and remark the locations. McLaughlin Mountain Park Phase 2, the information is the DCNR, when they're going to get back to us. And nothing new on the Washington and James development. And then as I added on here, Lori and I went to a PennDOT comprehensive project meeting last Thursday, and they talked about the design of the Chartier Street, Washington Avenue intersection, and all the other projects that they're doing in this portion of the district. They don't have any major paving programs in this portion of the district this year, just maybe some maintenance. They did mention, and I'll bring it up, about our neighboring community upstream on McLaughlin Run is proposed roundabout at the intersection of McLaughlin Run right there at Pine Ridge Commons. So their challenge right now is having to deal with the post office in federal government to acquire land to do it. So until they do that, they won't be able to move forward.
Thank you, George, for getting the fence done.
Welcome.
Yeah.
Looks much better.
Fire chief, we're chilling out.
Thanks, Mr. President. Sent somebody a message over the weekend. A lot of people, if you went by, we had a huge training session over the weekend at the house next door. We actually brought a instructor up from South Carolina, who used to be a city Pittsburgh fireman, plus a good friend of mine, taught a RIC class. It's Rapid Intervention Team, and the purpose of it is to teach us how to rescue firemen in a collapse or in a fire to get them out alive in a very, very reasonable amount of time. This guy pioneered this since the Bryson Street fire back on Valentine's Day in 95, because he was part of that. So that's what it was, and these guys were pushed through, beat up, in holes, everything else, all weekend long. And they're hurting today, I'll tell you that much. But very good, very successful training with everybody left over the weekend. It was a nice class. So that's what went on. If people went by to see what it was, there was about 25 students in the class. So it was a nice sized class for it. So that was that. The other things I got is we have the Easter egg hunt coming up on Saturday down in Chartiers Park. It will start at 11 a.m. And then last I have is Cash Bash is also coming up. A lot of things like that. That's coming up on May 6th. It's that first Saturday in May. And that's all I got, Brother President.
Thank you very much. Dan's not here. Library delegate. Becky, do you have anything?
Yes, I do.
You don't have to. No, it's tough to say. This
is an exhaustive journey that I've lived. But it's been good. I just wanted to... I'm going to pass out an article. I do believe you probably read it in the signal item that replaced the Bridgeville Area News. I just wanted to, I highlighted what I thought was most pertinent. Kim Lyons, who wrote the article, did a really nice job. My only comment would really be that this affects the libraries in the Allegheny County Library System. It's not just the Library of Carnegie and Sewickley. And also, this is National Library Week. It's going to be observed between April 9th and the 15th, and the theme is Libraries Transform. And I wanted to add that I recently attended an ACLA meeting, and I thought it was important. I thought there were some key words used tonight, dovetail, working with other communities, sharing services, sharing the thoughts and actions of others, and making a bigger impact, and having being able, if you're little, then little becomes a little bit bigger, it becomes a little bit more confident and stronger. And one of the things that library personnel and volunteers and even board members who participate in the Bridgeville Public Library and some of the Allegheny County Library Association libraries can participate with a USX is offering an opportunity for people to have an opportunity for the word an opportunity for some insurance through the a credit union, through the USX credit union, which I thought was a really nice opportunity. That's not really something that our library board is having to scramble together to get the funds. I also want to make a really pause here for a moment to thank you for the $20,000 that you did contribute to the library to help to support the library and the activities of the library. And the article that I've shared with you is, at the federal level, the budget funding has been cut that will affect libraries. The state of Pennsylvania has had flat funding for supportive libraries. So we have to be ever conscientious of the funding and concern regarding the RAD funds too, because RAD becomes very desirable for others. And it is a good opportunity, and it helps, has helped the libraries tremendously.
And one of the last things that I learned is the computer program for individuals who come into the library and have access to the internet, to software, to possibly writing a resume, to looking for a job. The value of that is about $70,000. So for some, for our community to afford that out of our pockets, for our board to scramble together for that, I think that's a wonderful opportunity, because I want to know what the values are. That really helps me get a better picture. And I do appreciate your financial support, and I look forward to our future continuation support from the community of Bridgeville. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks. I don't think there's anybody here from the Parking Authority, is there? All right. Planning Commission.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry I never checked the Planning Commission was on the agenda from Dallas over here. A couple of meetings ago, we had some drawing, which I believe I saw this way before. This was made by Joe and the young lady there, Carol. Perception, idea. My theory is a bit different. Perception to me, I figure it's like a dream. Didn't come true or not. It's theory. We need the reality of it. Okay? How we do that? It's very simple. We have to keep on doing that, keep on doing, put a thing together. And of course it depends on the financial situation as well. I understand that. We definitely need to put something together so we can go for grant. A grant takes time, and there are grants available when you have something to show. I proposed last meeting that we have to work on four things. We have to work on Bower Hill, we have to work on Baldwin Street, we have to work on McLaughlin, and we have to work on North End. Those are what's remaining. There are many other things remaining, Richard, of course, but those are very important to do that. Now, I know we can't ask for rent for all that. It takes a lot of money to put them together. But if we can put them all in a comprehensive plan, all those four things, which we've been saying for a long time, maybe we can pick up what would be the best thing to put in our dream, if you will. Really, it tells you everything in a couple of words, in a few words. Very simple. The meeting every month, they're important. But if we don't have anything to talk about it, really, what the hell are we going there for? Dale and I, the committee, we speak on the phone all the time. But if we keep on having some like this ready, we can look at them and study it, then pass to you guys and put them together and put them out for grant. And maybe in my lifetime, I'll be able to see something of these couple of things, because I don't know. If I don't see it, somebody else will. Good. So thank you.
Thank you, Neil.
We're waiting on a number of people.
Right. I talked to Carolyn before she went on vacation at the end of March, and I had asked her to have a number for me for this meeting, but unfortunately I didn't get it. And my concern is there's about $2,900 in the budget as far as planning goes. And if it's within that amount, fine. If it's above that amount, I want to bring it to you guys just to see if you want to move forward with that. So that's where we are right now. So I'm waiting for it. When she gives me the number, I'll shoot it off to you. But if it's within the budget numbers, and they can just...
Joe, what kind of timeline are you talking for conceptual?
I haven't talked with Carolyn lately, and there's no reason why I would say a conceptual plan could be turned around in maybe 6 weeks or something like that. Put the ideas together, get it on paper, I think that's a part of all this.
And that's what we're waiting for, is to bring back to the planning commission.
Thank you.
Borough manager?
I provided a report, if anybody has any questions. Just one other comment I wanted to make is that we already had to send our letter to our salt supplier, letting them know that we wish to opt in for another year. And we're probably going to have to purchase, we have to purchase 80% of what we state that we are going to buy. We normally reserve 900 tons. We can buy up to 125% of that. We have to buy 80% of that. So we're still probably going to have to buy 245 tons.
Commissioner, we still have a lot left over. Can we use a lot this year?
We have approximately $78,000 in the snow budget. Yeah. That includes overtime and regular time and salt. So we probably have to buy about $15,000 worth of salt. It's going to be a question of whether we can store it down in the storage area or whether I'm going to get a price to see how much they'll store it for us. So. But we still have to spend that.
We did well.
It's an interesting problem to have.
Everybody has
it. Exactly. Now we have to pay someone to store the salt that we have to buy.
Some places have to buy thousands of tons. So that's where we are with that. And another pole was hit on Washington Avenue. Another decorative pole was hit this weekend. So this will be our third one this year that we had to replace. It was cracked totally in half, and the masthead above that was damaged, and track systems looked at that, and that has to be replaced too. We do have the insurance information of the person that hit it, but we just can't keep poles up. I mean, it's just one. We just finished putting the last pole in last week.
Yeah. And where was this?
This is right in front of a fine house. Coming out, they came out and made a right turn and ran right into the poles. So.
You're getting good at putting them back.
I know, they're getting really good at putting them back. So.
We should just buy an extra one.
We do have an extra one, actually. We have one downstairs, so their insurance will pay for another one, but we always do have an extra one. But we'll have to get another globe. So.
Thanks a lot. Old business.
I was pretty disappointed not to see a delegate from the Parking Authority show up this month. Last month I had some questions for them that went unanswered. I was pretty disappointed when I left last month to the result of the conversations that we had. For me personally, I feel like there's a lot of things that people are concerned with in Bridgeville, things that we have issues with, traffic being, parking being another. A lot of these things are very difficult, very long-term, very big issues, and as you can see from the bridge widening, all the stuff that's going on, these are works in progress. In my opinion, what I feel like as I sit here and when I look at Bridgeville and I think of myself as a councilman and what I want to do for the borough, I look at keeping businesses here, keeping citizens happy, making sure everyone's safe. And I think one of the issues that I've heard the most from business, actually not positive, the thing I've heard the most from business owners in Bridgeville is the issue they've had with parking. And that falls on the Parking Authority, and we don't govern the Parking Authority. So we run into a situation where we have people that are angry with us. I think that, I know I agree that it's an issue, and I would like to see some results come from it. To the point where our names have been posted and our emails have been posted, you know, in anger for things that are happening. And that's fine because we are public officials, and that's the reason why we reached out to the Parking Authority to try to find out some solutions to the problem that we're having. I really think we're going to have to start looking at something, looking into some options, or at least looking into costs, solutions, problems, because it was pretty much made very clear that they're not interested in getting any of that information to us, and they're not going to look at it. So I don't know exactly what we can do, because once again, we don't govern the parking authority, but I do find it an issue that, as the council here, we're seeing an issue that we have business owners complaining about. We have very large developments going on all around us that are going to bring in a whole lot of businesses. The last thing in the world we want to do is drive businesses out or have a reason why people don't want to come here and go to our businesses. So I don't know what the solution is. I was hoping that they would be here this month and we could talk about it a little bit more, and hopefully there have been slight change of thought process there, but obviously that's not the case. So I just want to put it out there. I don't know what anybody else's thoughts are on it. I'm just speaking from my own personal feelings on the subject, but I do believe that we have an issue at hand, and we need to start really looking into it before we get any deeper in this hole when these communities build these developments and we start actually losing people. But I think that would be very bad for Bridgeville if we lost some of our main restaurants and businesses that are in our borough. They're great places. We should be trying to take care of them and our citizens.
All right, thanks, Neil.
Yes, if I may, when you get this, page 2, support your local businesses. We have people who have donated some money. Everyone come in down there, put your name in the bucket. The end of the month, you'll get if your name is pulled, you'll get a $25 gift certificate to one of these places. Oh, right. This is our first step. Our board felt very necessary.
That's very smart.
It's a beginning. It's a beginning.
Everything counts, though. Right. Everything matters.
New business.
Motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you very much.